Torah in the courts of heaven. This is Torah portion, Lech Lecha. As we've already spoken, this season about Torah portions will be as it relates to the courtrooms of heaven. In this Torah portion, which is Genesis chapter 12, where we begin today, it's decisions that you could say that the Lord has made for Abraham in the courtrooms of heaven. It's decisions that he's going to do for Abraham. The first one is, I will make you a great nation. And of course, we know that eventually Abraham's seed will become the nation Israel. And actually, anyone who would come along beside Israel in the fact of accepting Yeshua, they also will be blessed as well. He says, I will bless you. And he says, I will make your name great. And of course, we all know of Abraham's name. And you could say that Abraham is the father of three religions, if you want to think of it as a religion, but actually it's a relationship. He says, you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse him who curses you. And in saying that, we need to be very careful that we always bless the children of Israel, because God has told us very specifically that he will bless those who bless them and curse those who curse them. The seventh one is, in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. To your descendants I will give this land. And of course, we know the land of Israel was given to them by the Lord. They would actually drive out nations who were full of sin, and God would give them their land. But the Lord will plague Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So in that decision is when Abraham, if you remember, told Sarah to tell Pharaoh that she was his sister, which indeed she was his half-sister. However, she was married to him. She was also, of course, his wife. And Abraham did this to try to protect himself. Then, as we know, Pharaoh was plagued from the Lord because of his thoughts about Sarah. The next one, the tenth decision, is, it says, lift your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward, for all the land which you see, I will give to you and your descendants forever. So this was the time when Abraham was taken out by the Lord and told to look in all these directions, basically all the way around him, and as far as he could see in every direction, that land was going to be his and his descendants forever. The next one is, I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants could be numbered. Just Genesis 13, 14 through 16. The next one is, and be blessed of God Most High, who's delivered your enemies into your hand, and he gave them tithe of all. Genesis 14, 20. So even though Abraham was very blessed, he would still have to go out and protect what was his and fight enemies. And it's the same with us. Even though we are loved of God and highly favored, we still have to do our part. We have to still protect and take care of what God has done for us and what he has given to us. So the next one, it says, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. So two more decisions that were given to Abraham from the Lord, that he was going to be his shield, in other words, his protection, and also he was going to be his reward. You know, when we think about all that the Lord has blessed you with and all that the Lord wants to give you, you know, really and truly, the greatest reward we have one day is we will be with Yeshua. We will be with him in his heavenly kingdom, which will come to earth in the shape, in the form of the New Jerusalem. But the greatest reward of all still is the fact that we will be with the Lord. The next decision, which is 14, he says, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Here he's speaking about the fact that, you know, he had a son, which was Ishmael, but Ishmael was from the concubine Hagar. But this son, the son that was going to be his true heir, was going to be Isaac, who, of course, came from Sarah. The next decision, 15, then he brought him outside and said, "Look now toward heaven and count the stars if you are able to number them." And he said to him, "So shall your descendants be." So the first time the Lord tells Abraham that his seed was going to be like the dust of the earth. It's going to be so numerous. There's going to be so many people. It would be like trying to count the dust of the earth. And now he's taking him, having him look into heaven and saying to him, "Look at the stars. Your descendants are going to be so numerous that you won't even be able to count them." Then he says, "And he believed in the Lord, and he accounted to him for righteousness." The decision here was that Abraham believed. And this is huge. This is how each one of us are saved. It's not for anything we have done or ever could do. It's for the fact that we believe, that faith that God has actually given us in believing his work is how we are saved. And it's also accounted to us for righteousness. Genesis 15, 4 through 6. This demonstrates Abraham's salvation, that he believes and trusts in God. Now we want to go to Genesis 15, 8. And he said, "Lord God, how shall I know that I will inherit it?" So he said to him, "Bring me a 3-year-old heifer, a 3-year-old female goat, a 3-year-old ram, and a turtle dove, and a young pigeon." Then he brought all these to him and cut them in two, down the middle, and placed each piece opposite the other. But he did not cut the birds in two. And when the vultures came down on the carcasses, Abraham drove them away. Now when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell on Abram. And behold, horror and great darkness fell upon him. Then he said to Abram, "Know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them for 400 years. This is a very amazing thing, because here the Lord is making the covenant with Abraham. And this was, if we were from that, you know, Middle Eastern ideology and that understanding, we would know this is a covenant, and it's a blood covenant. And God was going to make this covenant with Abraham. And then he says to him, your descendants are going to be strangers in a land that's not theirs, and they will serve them for 400 years. And this is very interesting, because that's exactly what would happen as the children of Israel would have to go into Egyptian bondage. And we know that story is coming up, but that's exactly what would happen. For 400 years, a prophecy is given about Abraham's descendants, and they would be in this slavery, and then he would bring them out, which is exactly what happens. We can even know this from secular history. Now, in Genesis 15, 17, and it says, "It came to pass, when the sun went down and it was dark, that behold, there was appearing a smoking oven and a burning torch that passed through the pieces. On the same day, Yahweh made a covenant with Abraham, saying, 'To your descendants I have given this land from the river Egypt, the great river, the river Euphrates.'" So, you see, Abraham made this covenant with God, but in essence, he didn't do anything. He simply did the part of believing and cut the animals, and then he was going to try to guard the animals, if you look at the whole story, but God put him to sleep. And why did he put him to sleep? But it shows us that when God makes a covenant with man, he knows that man cannot keep the covenant. We are imperfect beings. Because of the fall, we are imperfect. So we cannot keep the promises to God. So in this instance, God put Abraham to sleep. And it's the sense of the father and the son walking through the halves. So basically, God kept the covenant with himself. Now, there's an interesting thing about these animals and being cut in two. So when someone would make a covenant, an ancient covenant like this, the two people that were entering the covenant would cut the animals in two, and then they would walk through the pieces of and the blood, and they would say, may this and worse happen to me or happen to you if we don't keep the covenant. So as you see, it's a very grievous outcome if we don't keep the covenant. But God did this, and he walked through the covenant. And we know that we didn't keep the covenant. We couldn't keep the covenant. And guess what? You know, Yeshua was the one who would be beaten, and his blood would be given to make sure the covenant was kept. It's a beautiful and wonderful thing, these covenants. And now we see all the promises that has been made to Abraham through the Lord. And all these promises we get to enter in with the Jewish people, the people of Israel. We don't take their place. We don't push them out of the way. The covenant was made to them, but by being grafted in, as it speaks about this, and you've heard me say this if you've followed for any time, in Romans chapter 11, that we enter in because we've been grafted in to the olive tree. And so in the same sense, we are grafted into this covenant by faith in Yeshua. It's a wonderful thing to know that we have faith in the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and his son, Yeshua, who gave everything for us.